Hello everyone, here's Conscious Klaus from Ubud in Bali, and I'm super excited and thrilled to have here today my friend and teacher Shiva. He is very well known and very loved in the Ubud community. He's a tantrika, a life coach, and he's an activator of evolved codes, if I understood that correctly.
Evolutionary codes.
Evolutionary codes.
For the planet of mankind.
Yes, and I want to hear more about that. And he is hosting a lot of events here. So I'm now proud to be part of his Brotherhood of Kings and the Jaya Tribe.
Jaya Tribe, yeah.
Jaya Tribe. Welcome, Shiva.
Thank you.
We met.
Super excited to be here.
Thank you. We met I think I was 5 years ago at Akasha, where I saw you leading this group of 100, 200 people.
Yes.
At this amazing party. It's like, wow, this guy. And now I have you sitting here. I'm super excited.
Beautiful.
Yes. Amazing. So first, could you tell us a little bit about your work, what you do, and then a little bit about who you are? But let's talk a little bit about you, what you're doing here, how you're transforming the world.
Beautiful. So the core intention behind everything that I do is to find ways of optimizing and upgrading what we are doing as human beings. So first for myself, right? Train, I optimize my nutrition, I try to optimize my communication, be intentional with what I do. And so this is for myself. But then in my work as a coach or as a tantrika, it is to bring the teachings and bring tactics, strategies, techniques, awakening practices that are going to help you evolve from where you are to where you would like to be. Sometimes you are going to be in your life and you have a desire, right? You have a wish to activate something that is not yet fully manifested. Mm-hmm. And then my job is to be like, I've got here. I've got a couple of tools or a couple of techniques that might help you along the way. So help you transition or help you upgrade every aspect of your life. So that's one thing. Another one, when it comes to mysticism, to the mystical awakening within the tantric field, the code word is precisely awakening. Awakening, what does it mean to wake up? It means that to be able to look at the physical reality and be like, okay, now we are going to go above and be able to go into the spiritual reality. It means that beyond the limits of the physical reality, there is an invisible reality, an invisible life in the energetics, but also in the connection with gods and goddesses, with angelic powers, with the different creative hierarchies that are on this planet, sharing this earth with humankind. I believe there is a lot going on out there, and part of that, when we wake up, it means that we establish a connection with aspects of ourselves that go beyond the limits of our personality and the matrix that we live in. That's the idea in a few words.
Wow. And how long have you been doing this work? How long have you been here in Ubud doing this work? And did you do this before or did this start here?
Yeah, well, the journey in Ubud started 2012, so it has been 12 years. The real temple where I am now is 10 years. And before that, yeah, I started when I was, my first book on yoga was from Sri Aurobindo, Yoga Integral, when I was 13. So I started diving into it. I was practicing yoga actively when I was 16, and then I went into martial arts and so on. So the journey has been 40 years or more along that line, and really actively diving into it. I quit my career as a geologist, and since then it has been, 30, really diving deep. It has been 35 years of exploration.
Wow.
back to 1989, this is where the initiation journey really
1989.
Started.
Yes. Wow. I think I was still, I can't remember how old I was back then. But what has changed in your life by becoming a very well-known, established person here in Bali?
What has changed?
Yes, what has changed? How has your life upgraded?
The way it upgrades is that I keep on perfecting every aspect of my life. It means that, for instance, when I arrived over here, I had some ideas about nutrition, about communication or relationship or sex life. So I keep upgrading all the time. Anytime, you know, I wake up in the morning, for instance, this morning, I tested new techniques, I tested new breathing techniques, mm-hmm. and I'm constantly researching. So when you come into my house, it's a little bit like a laboratory, right? It's like you arrive over there and it's like scientific experiments, but on an energetic level. And I test things, I go like, okay, for instance, the other day I did some retention breath, right? I went to 2 minutes and more, and then I noticed what's happening. I noticed some different layers of bliss that are kicking in. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, oh, something's going on. It made me feel really good. And so I test that, and then I go further and come back. And so it's all about, it's very experimental.
Yeah. So you bring, apparently, your knowledge about science and the scientific method into spirituality?
Yes. I'm very analytical. So you see, I have some models over here with different concepts about spirituality. So instead of just being like, okay, let's be in our flow and try and release emotions, it's like I've got like structures and models about life that are really anchoring my field. So I'm very analytical. It means that since I started with my coaching practice, the coaching itself was 2002, I have been documenting absolutely everything that I'm doing. Great. I might have a coaching session with you, and then I will take notes on all of that, analyze the flow of the session, and so it's very, you know, I bring the scientific method into that to kind of make sense of all of that. So my mind is very engaged.
Great. Fantastic. So like I'm interested in the spirituality, but my expertise in what I do is like I help men, especially conscious men, to get better, to master the art of dating, intimacy, sexuality,
yes.
and relationships.
Yes.
And you're in the world of tantra, so I guess there's a lot of knowledge you have, and you also work in this workshop where together was about coupling.
Yes.
And you had especially great thing, what you were talking about, like, it was called relationship values.
Yes.
So I would like to go into asking you a couple of questions. The first one would be, let's talk a little bit about Ubud, you know, so we're like a conscious people, conscious community. Ubud is a very well-known conscious community, but what does that actually mean? What does it mean to you?
Yeah, it's a word that might be a little bit overused. For me, what it means, conscious, it means that it's intentional. Conscious means that we're not just waking up in the morning and whatever, drinking coffee and watching the news and getting all entangled into the things of life. It's like there is a part of us which is really looking at things and analyzing and looking at the places where we can evolve. So the conscious part of it is, for instance, if we do an event and there is a big celebration, instead of having alcohol and smoking and everything that is happening in the traditional world, then we are going to do alcohol-free, we are going to have very clear boundaries and container, substance-free, yeah, we bring the cacao, but the intention is going to be to go a little bit beyond the traditional way of partying, for instance. So it's intentional and conscious, instead of just being unconscious and asleep. But this is not something that is an insult to the rest of the world. I think that the world is doing great, you know, people are conscious. We live in a world where people are quite awake, you know, compared with where we were as cavemen. So we don't use this word because it's better or worse than the rest of the world. We are, you know, we're doing our best, and the word conscious or intentional seems to match the intention of what we're doing here.
Yeah.
So that's the way I would put it.
This is exactly like my experience when I became conscious. My awakening was actually through meditation. So
yes.
I discovered meditation, and what I discovered was that actually I'm not thinking, but thinking is happening automatically. So I became aware that actually my life was on autopilot,
yes.
like 99%, and I would think that I'm doing the things that I'm doing because I intend to do them, but that was actually not the case. And actually through meditation I noticed I'm not the thinker, because I want to sit just a few minutes in silence and focus on my breath, but my mind kept going all by itself. So for me, this is where my definition is from, like being conscious is actually waking up out of the autopilot, and as you said, living intentionally.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah. And there is another element that we can bring into that, the consciousness and the intentionality means, conscious means also being aware of the impact of our actions or our choices.
Yes.
Right? So instead of just like making the traditional choices, eating junk food and so on, it's like, okay, I ate junk food yesterday. Here is the consequence of how I'm feeling today. Does that increase my power, increase my health, increase my joy? No. Okay, so what can I do to increase my health, power, joy, my love to the planet, to humankind? So intentional means we look at our actions, our choices, and we look at the consequences of our choice as well. For me, that's a big part of being intentional and conscious.
Yes, thank you so much. So Ubud is also seems to be very popular for women. Why do you think is this the case?
Well, it's just you know, one of the centers of Ubud is the yoga barn, right? So you have we have like probably three or four major yoga schools over here, and the yoga world attracts more women than men. If you go to a yoga teacher training, for instance, it's going to be probably 90% women, maybe a few isolated men over there, because women are attracted more to the yoga field than the men. So this is why naturally there is a field over here which is a little bit more female oriented. But yeah, we've got a good tribes of brothers as well. There is going to be more men in Canggu, right? Because then it's more of a tech world, you know, digital nomads, yeah. And so on. So men are going to be a little bit more in the tech world, we're a little bit more into the field of yoga and tantra.
Yeah. And what do you think for you, what does it mean to be a conscious man? Because it seems the women here, they're also interested in conscious men. They don't necessarily want the guys who drink and smoke and party. What does it mean to be a conscious man? I mean, it's probably what you said already. But
in the context of relating, for instance, and dating, or in the context
yes.
of interacting with, for us, interacting with women, it is being, again, being aware of what we are doing.
Yeah.
Aware of our actions, aware of our conversations, what are the words. For instance, if I'm having a date with a woman and I'm like bragging about myself and constantly talking about myself, and I don't notice where she's at, I don't ask questions about herself, I touch her in ways that might be inappropriate, or so the intentionality or the conscious an awakened man is going to kind of be like, okay, I see a woman, I see her, and
yeah.
instead of being like, I'm going to force my agenda in her, I'm going to look at what she needs, or how can I serve this goddess, beautiful goddess energy.
Yeah.
So it's the intention is very different. Instead of just arriving and you're going to be my wife, I want to have kids with you, it's like, who is this woman? You know,
yeah.
being really interested
curiosity.
In her. Curiosity, and also, how can I help you? How can I serve you?
Serving instead of taking. This is a very important frame.
Yes. You know, in the wheel of consent, right, you have the taking, allowing, and then you have the giver, receiver,
yeah.
right? So it's not necessarily as polarized as that, but when I see a woman, I go like, okay, where are you at in your life? What is the role that I can play in your evolution? So it's very intentional from that angle.
Great. Thank you so much. All right. Yeah, so let's stay with this a little bit. There's like this terms in the tantra community which talk about the mature versus the immature masculine and the mature versus the immature feminine.
Yes.
If there's anything that hasn't been said already,
yes.
maybe you could add something, or maybe you even have a graphic. I'm pretty sure you have a lot of graphics.
Yes, exactly.
One of them in your house.
A few things like that. Well, you know, to put it simply, the distinction between mature and immature, right? Mature means, again, means aware. Mature means I'm taking an action, for instance, even if I'm for instance, in a shadow emotion. A shadow emotion might be anger. That's a typical dark shadow emotion, classical. So if I'm in my anger, in my immature anger, I'm going to be dominated by that emotion. I'm enslaved by the emotion.
Mm-hmm.
It means that the emotion takes over, and I'm out of my center. When it's a mature, when I'm in my mature dark masculine, in my mature anger or rage, I am master of that emotion.
Mm-hmm.
I am master. I'm riding the wave. I'm enjoying my anger. I'm enjoying my rage. I'm choosing when and how it appears. Yes. You know, like for instance, if I'm not in my maturity right now and I'm angry, I'm going to hit the table and break things and be out of balance, right? So for me, that's the fundamental difference between mature and immature. Mature means I am actually the one leading that emotion, directing it. I'm master of that emotion. When I'm immature, I'm enslaved by the emotion.
So this is a very interesting aspect. Do you think it's possible that like a conscious person may actually say, oh, there are certain emotions which are bad, they're unconscious, and thereby actually repress them?
Yes. Well, I mean, everybody, the being conscious or unconscious is not just a zero to, you know, is not just one or the other, it's not black and white. We can have awareness about certain things and unawareness about other things. So I might be conscious about certain things, and then somebody comes and points at me and says, when you're doing that, I don't think that's very mature. I'm like, oh wow, yeah, you're right, actually. I was behaving like a kid.
Yeah.
I was behaving like a child. I was in reactive mode. So I'm going to look at it and then keep on evolving. So there are lots of things that might be happening in our field. Emotions, reactions, desires and things that are very animalistic, very basic and completely still unconscious. You know, here is what I know that I know, then there is what I know that I don't know, and then there is what I don't know that I don't know. It's just like there is a vast field of things. So it's all according to, you know, to a certain scale, to a certain inner scale. And like, yeah, you're kind of conscious, you're kind of awake. And there is more.
And what about the feminine? What would be typical examples for the immature versus the mature feminine?
For the immature versus the mature feminine, it's the same distinction that we can use. For instance, if I am dating a woman and this woman tends to be very manipulative or dominant or controlling and coming out of trigger or
jealous.
There is lots of jealous, for instance, but jealousy can be mature. There is going to be lots of situations where jealousy will be justified. So for instance, if I have a woman and she gets very insecure about everything and she cannot control that emotion, that's going to be immature. But if she comes to me and says, you know what, the other day when you were chatting with your ex over there, I felt really triggered by it. That's a mature jealousy response. And she says, I just want you to know that when you do that, it really hurts my feelings.
So this is maybe also like a good way about like emotions, dealing with them in general, instead of saying, oh, I'm this conscious person, I don't have jealousy or don't have anger. It's like, say, no, like I feel anger. And I'm open to share, hey, you know, like what you said was very triggering, it made me feel anger, but not acting on the anger or not acting on the jealousy by like breaking something or yelling, but actually saying like, hey, this is something that was triggering me. Maybe even adding something like, hey, this was not necessarily even what you did, but I still want to share that I felt this way.
Exactly.
It's triggering me.
Exactly. So, for instance, with jealousy, it's a really good example because you can have mature expressions of jealousy and immature expressions of jealousy. I use the words justified or unjustified. Probably 95% of the jealousy outbreaks that we have in today's world are unjustified.
Yeah.
They come out of fear, not of what's happening, but what could be happening.
Yeah.
So, the projection of something. Whereas there are many, many situations where when I get jealous about something, I had sometimes jealousy outbreaks that were completely justified. It felt really good to be jealous.
Yeah.
It felt really good to express it. It felt good to voice it. It felt good to establish a boundary.
Yes.
And I was there. I was, you know, of course there might be some vulnerability, but I have the feeling that I'm surfing the emotion from a place which is mature, which is actually serving the relationship. See, if we want to go a little bit deeper into that topic, the jealousy is a set of behaviors, emotional reactions that has been designed by our nature, our instincts to protect the relationship. That's, if you look at positive jealousy, this is what it is. Positive jealousy is like if a woman gets jealous because the man has the tendency to flirt too much and go out there, what she's saying is like, if my man leaves, then the safety of my children is not going to be guaranteed.
Yeah.
So you go back to cave behaviors, go that 400,000 years ago in the plains of Africa, in the beginning of humankind. You go like, this is what has been established at that point. The woman needs to have the psychic power to project an energy so that the man doesn't go and run away with another woman from a rival tribe, because then the children would not have would have less chance of survival.
Yeah.
So that's where the original jealousy comes. And nowadays we go like, oh, you're just being jealous. And it's a shaming thing.
Yeah.
And you go like, and maybe it's like, yeah, I'm jealous. Yeah, I think my jealousy right now is really healthy.
Jealousy is even in the animal kingdom. Like you sometimes see videos where like there's a new dog in the house and the old dog is just like completely
stoic.
Sad, yeah. Or stoic.
Yes,
or something
exactly.
Like this.
Exactly.
Yeah.
It's a very primal emotion, and nowadays, you know, it's again, it's like we learn ways of navigating it. Words, find the right words. If I'm jealous and my partner is right there, I say, I cannot believe you. Ah, pisses me off when, you know, it's like she's going to be reacting to that.
Yeah.
She's going to feel afraid.
Yeah.
But if I say, interesting.
So I think this is a very interesting topic because what I see a lot, and this is something where some comedians even make fun of, is that people understand by the conscious community as something like there's a certain code of behavior, there's a certain way you need to look and dress and certain things you should eat and not eat, and something like you need to wear particular clothes or particular emotions are inappropriate, you should never be angry and so on. And this
sounds very immature to me.
Yeah, that sounds very immature. So it's not about like hitting a specific code, or you know, like people who film themselves meditating and doing all this kind of stuff, not just to be seen in a particular way, just fit in, but actually to be aware of who you are, what you do, and taking over the intention about how I want to act, who I want to be, instead of running on autopilot.
Yeah, you know, for me, the simple way to put it is like, be real, be in your truth, do whatever works for you. You know, it's like this is a field. This is why there is so much diversity on this planet, because we are humans. So if we create a culture which starts locking us into very specific behaviors, it's like nobody decides for me what my masculinity will be. I express my masculinity whatever way I want, and say, oh, you are being too feminine. I say, well, that's the judgment or projection of who you are. Like, I love having the diversity of play and creating freedom with create space, not restrictions and new rules and simply a new matrix that we have to abide.
Yes. Right. So there was something very interesting you said yesterday. If I remember right, you said that for you it's more important that your woman is in her truth rather than to be loyal to you. Is that, do I remember that correctly?
Yes.
What you said in the end?
Yes. You want me to repeat
yes,
that?
Yes, please.
So the, you know, the idea, for instance, in boundaries, when you are in a relationship, you can be like, I don't want you, I give you a control pattern to lock you within the loyalty with me. And for me, the way I put it usually, it's like, meet this woman, I say, of course I want you to be loyal, but I want you to be in your truth first.
Mm.
It's more important for me that you are in your truth. So what this means is that if at some point our commitment to our relationship comes to an end because suddenly another man comes in your life that is going to take you to the next level of your evolution, then I embrace that, you know, fully. And of course, it's not just black and white. There might be triggers, there might be responses, but that's the ideal. The mindset or the way we communicate very often boundaries in the relationship that I had in the past.
Great. Fantastic. So this leads me into my next series of questions about Tantra. So you're a tantrika, and my first question would be like, we all know that Tantra, different people have different ideas of Tantra. So what does Tantra mean to you personally? What does it mean to you to be a tantrika?
So for me, Tantra is a complete path of life mastery or a path of awakening. It's a mystical reality. Imagine that we have this sphere or this spirit or this angelic force like that that is all over the planet and humankind. And when we tap into that, then it gives us the pathways of awakening, the pathways of reconnecting to source, the pathways to go back to a state of union. So that's the way I define it. It's a complete path of life mastery and the path of awakening. When we go back into the ancient classical tantra teachings, very often the teachings have a lot to do with lifestyle. They have to do with the thought patterns and how to show up and how to create abundance and so on. So for instance, there is a code word that is artha, A-R-T-H-A, and I discovered that in my own pathway. And then when I go and check back into the ancient teachings, that word is already present as the code word for, you know, mastering the field of abundance and the field of relationship to money and to the material reality or to the material abundance. So the field of Tantra, for me, it's really that. It is a complete path of life mastery and the path of awakening. That's how I summarize it.
Great. So if you look in the original Indian Tantra, it talks a lot about Shiva and Shakti. And this is actually, for me, also like this connection to the ancient Tantra of Shiva and Shakti. So your name is Shiva.
Yes.
Could you tell us a little bit about like what you understand by Shiva and Shakti, and I guess the divine masculine and feminine?
Yes. So I feel like the god or the energy of Shiva is very central to Tantra. That's where I connect with the tantric field. And then there is the divine feminine as well, in the form of Shakti, in the form of Kali. For me, the center of the relationship is Shiva and Kali. That's very central in my like. Kali is like my primary partner in a way. It's like that energy has been with me for like 25 years. Anytime I have any challenge in my life, I go back to Kali, because I feel like this is an energy that is really nurturing me.
And what does it mean to go back to Kali? How does it help you when you go through a challenge?
Go back to Kali, it means that go back to this energy that burns down the shadows, burn down the obstacles. If I'm triggered by something and I feel like, and I feel a contraction in my field, I feel like I'm not happy, I'm not digesting a specific emotion, then I go into the jungle, I sing to Kali, and that brings me back to a state of energetic and emotional freedom. So imagine that the energy of Kali has the power to destroy the demons, has the power to destroy the shadows, to clear out of your field everything that doesn't serve you. Mm. So everything that might be immature, when Kali comes into my field, and sometimes she comes into my field through a woman, through a lover, she's going to start attacking the places inside of me that might be weak or maybe out of integrity or, you know, not fully aligned. Mm. And so I get, you know, like for instance, I might become too rigid on certain things, too dogmatic almost about certain things.
So you could say it's like kind of a form of the dark feminine?
Yes. Yes, Kali for me is like the central aspect of the dark feminine.
Nice, that's great. Because in the conscious community, I think when men talk about my woman became a Kali, it often means like, wow, she got really angry about something.
Yeah, it can come in the form of anger intensity. When you look at the pictures and images of Kali, it's like, it's very intense. You say, why would we call that energy in our field? Well, what I can tell you is that one of the reasons why I'm so happy in life is because Kali is an integral part of my life. Because it keeps my system clean. It keeps me in a state of emotional freedom, energetic and emotional freedom. So, this is why Kali is in my field.
Okay, this is very inspiring because I just started doing like Om Namah Shivaya, Om Namah Shivaya regularly, and actually connecting to the divine masculine for clarity, focus, strength. But the very interesting aspect to also work with the Shakti and the divine feminine.
Yes.
So this is very inspirational.
Yes.
All right. So my field is actually what I do is like I help guys who are maybe not so experienced with women, dating, sexuality, and spirituality. To get better in these fields. And
yes.
I see, I go to many Tantra festivals and live in conscious communities and see these guys who want to be in the world of Tantra and want to be better with women and they're just not there yet. So what do you think, what can men learn from Tantra about, for example, dating women?
Mm-hmm. So, I want to make a very strong distinction, okay? It's like, on one hand, you have mysticism, you have like this aspiration to inner union. Like for instance, when you practice yoga and you go on the yoga mat, you do your poses, you do your prayers, and everything wakes up into this real. And then there is everything that happens in the field of relationship, personal development, dating, and so on. So there is mysticism, mm-hmm. and then there is personal development. Mm-hmm. So very often those two things overlap. When we talk about Tantra in that context, we are sliding into the field of personal development.
Yes.
So sometimes we are going to use the Tantra within that context, and sometimes I go like, I'm not sure if we can call it Tantra. For me, Tantra becomes the moment where we start adding a mystical dimension to it, where there is an intentional relationship with the invisible, where there is something that happens within that context. So when we bring now the field of Tantra in the Neo-Tantra field, there is a lot of overlap and a lot of things that are a bit blurry in the limit. So that said, I believe that the field or the spirit of Tantra really, that's how I experience, it's a compassionate field. Yeah. It wants to help humankind where it hurts. Mm-hmm. And so if you are in love with a woman, right, and you go like, I would love to connect with that woman, but I don't know how to connect. It's like I'm there and I'm bubbling and I have no idea how to establish a connection with that person. Then imagine that the field of Tantra is like this energy that really wants to help and say, well, we're going to create a sacred marriage between those two human beings. Mm. And so very, very simple. It's like if I call in this tantric energy inside of me and I'm in front of a woman that I'm attracted to, naturally I'm going to start feeling this person as the resonance or the transmission of the goddess energy. It means that I look through her and then I see your Shakti, your divine transmission, you're the voice of my spirit. So instead of looking at the person just as a physical, you know, from the physical perspective, here is your personality. No, I look at the divinity in that person. It doesn't mean that I discard the personality, but it means that it becomes a completely part of the relationship.
So this is a great aspect, actually. This is exactly my experience, that like men who are not so much in Tantra and spirituality see women often as an object, as someone like, wow, she has this very hot body, she's got this beautiful face, and they get actually into like an energy of needing, wanting, which I think is not very attractive to women. While something I learned from Tantra is about, like, that's what I call like going into the Shiva energy, being really present and to see, as you said, the divine goddess and see her as a goddess and admire her as a goddess, but without wanting anything from her, without needing anything from her. Yes. This is also my connection to the, what I understand the ancient Tantra is, like Shiva is divine consciousness, and Shakti is all energy and manifestation. And the connection is that Shiva doesn't want to change anything. Shiva is just admiring the creation, the energy, Shakti. And this is also my metaphor for like actually relating to women, to stay in my presence, to stay in my consciousness, and to actually see and admire the woman, but without wanting anything and seeing her soul. This is like what I learned from transfiguration, to look into her eyes and see beyond the body, the personality, and seeing the divine.
Yes, exactly. So that's one aspect of relating and one way of establishing a tantric connection between you and a woman that you might be attracted to, right? Being there, being a protector. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, it's like, I think that the diversity of the emotions and the qualities that we can bring into a relationship is like there is a really vast field of possibilities.
Great. So there's one topic when I'm in Austria and I talk about Tantra. A lot of people say, oh yeah, Tantra, ha ha ha. And this is because, Tantra has been by the media, I think, maybe portrayed as just being about sexuality. So we know that this is not true, but still my question is, what can a man learn about sexuality or tantric sex? Or what's your take on tantric sex?
Yeah, I wrote a whole book about it.
So, oh wow.
So it's totally part of my you know, of my inspiration when connecting. So if you want to define tantric sex in very simple ways, It is that when you engage into traditional friction sex, it's going to be about the sexual pleasure, about the lust, about connecting with the person. When I engage into a tantric sex practice, then it's going to be about a prayer, about a celebration. It becomes a meditation. Instead of focusing on the sexual gratification, on the pleasure gratification, on the five senses, we enter into spaces that are beyond that. Mm-hmm. So we consciously offer the lovemaking to the divine. Right? For instance, if I'm over here and I enter into a breathing practice, and I'm going to be breathing, then that's a prayer, right? Mm-hmm. If I do a mudra, if I practice, if I sing some mantras, all that is a prayer. Now, if I have a partner and I'm doing that with a partner, then the context of what we're doing here suddenly activates the tantric temple, and then that becomes an offering to the divine.
So it's about creating like a ritual as well, would you say, with mudras?
Yes, it can be.
Instead
can
of
be.
Just like in the movies, you see, what I see is like this unconscious sexuality when the actors, they get together and all of a sudden they look into each other's eyes and just start to tear the clothes off. And for me, this is like the opposite, actually.
Well, it can happen within the tantric context. It means that it doesn't have to be a strict established ritual, but the core intention is to precisely have the awareness of that. Like most of the times when I'm with my partner, we're going to be singing mantras, we're going to be shaking, breathing. You know, before we start this interview, we go next door, we sing some mantras, we activate that.
Set intentions.
Yes, exactly. Because we want to bring in that energy. We want to activate the tantric temple. So that's very intentional. Like we didn't just come from town, sit down. It's like we've got yantras and tools and things, and I'm covered with symbology, and the same with you, right? So it's like, why do we do that? It's because that's the way we communicate with certain aspects of the invisible. And so when you engage into tantric sex, and instead of being like just in your bedroom with like technology everywhere and messy place, you are, you know, you put candles around, you clear the space, you put images around of secret divine divinities, and then you sing some mantras, and then you have an intentional ritual with your partner, then suddenly you open a space which is inviting the tantric temple to be manifested.
And you mentioned like an aspect, I think, before, like consecration, like instead of just like having sex on a physical level, to make it a divine act. Is that correct?
Yes. The core element behind that is that we are aware of the energetics. It's like if we eye gaze for like 1 minute, we are going to enter into very transcendental states straight away, right? Mm. Then if we breathe together, and right now we can create a connection brother to brother, you know, this is not a sexual connection, but we can create an energetic connection between the two of us that is going to take us deeper than anything we experienced before.
Yeah, so eye gazing, I think, is one of the most beautiful things I learned about Tantra. It's all called transfiguration, seeing the divine behind.
Yes.
Consecration, I think, goes hand in hand, where instead of just having sex, you actually do it for a higher purpose, like intentional, similar to how we set up intentions. And one thing that probably many people are interested in, something that's very strongly associated with Tantra for men, is actually semen retention or brahmacharya. Could I have your take on that?
I think that semen retention is a really good practice. And again, you know, when we go into semen retention, we go back to lifestyle choices. Like certain religions, you don't eat pig, don't eat an eye. In the Hindu religion, is like, vegetarian, you know. So those are choices, right? So those are lifestyle choices. In my experience, for instance, when you go into the Taoism, that's the same thing that is being stimulated, because they know that, or we know that semen contains a lot of life force. Mm. And by ejaculating, by releasing the semen, then you lose a lot of energy. In French, you say the little death. We call that the little death. After ejaculation, you have the refraction period that can last, you know, a few hours. But we know within the tantric field and within the conscious sexuality communities that the period the refraction period, how long does it take to regenerate the body to come back to full? About 3 weeks.
Yeah, right? And the energy that you build up, you can also use for purposes of sublimation, like bringing them to higher chakras or utilizing the built up sexual energy to bring it into your heart or bring it into your manipura or bring it into your third eye chakra. Or
exactly.
It's like even used as a technique for enlightenment, working with the sexual energy.
Exactly, exactly. And you know, even if you don't focus specifically on any form of technique, the fact that you have this reserve of energy that is not being just released is really powerful. The best way to find out about it is to try. Mm. It's like, for instance, my guess is that probably 70-80% of men on this planet are in a constant state of depletion.
Yeah.
What this means is that if you are ejaculating more than once a week, or it's just like there is the, we never catch the wave where you are fully replenished.
And it's probably different when you're young, I guess, than when you get older.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
So I think, like, in this context, that there was not a question on my list, but I think it's interesting since you say that, the role of pornography and how that might actually, for a man, actually limit him in his dating and relationship skills. What do you think about pornography?
Well, pornography is one of the core shadows of sex, right? Right now, as a human race, we score maybe a 20% in terms of how optimized we are in how we use our sexual energy. There's lots of rape, lots of abuse, there is lots of trauma. I would say probably 95% of people on this planet are sexually deprived in some form of another, some way or another. Men and women. I think that everybody would like to have more beautiful, deeper, better connection. You can be in a marriage for like 20 years and don't feel your partner and still have sex, and this becomes like something mechanical. So there is a potential here as human race that we are not tapping into. And the reason why, well, one of the reasons is because there has been so much suppression and so much taboo on the sexual world that then, you know, sex is not going to disappear. So it finds narrow and dark ways of staying present in the field, but then it becomes shamed, it becomes taboo, it becomes marginalized in ways that become really toxic and really unhealthy and immature. So, for instance, everything that has to do precisely with sexual abuse, with unhappy marriages, not understanding sexuality, the lack of sexual education in schools, things like that, all that have to do with the fact that there has been such a suppression and such a shaming of sexual energy that now we are in this space and we are starting to reclaim and rediscover the joy and the beauty. But think about that. It's just incredible that you will have, you know, people around the world getting sexually mutilated.
So this is a very, this is also not on my list, this question, but this is a question that has been for me fascinating for as long as I can think. And it's definitely not a question that you can answer easily.
Yes.
But in essence, sexuality is life. Like, without sexuality, we wouldn't live. Like, the only reason why you're here and why I'm here is that all our ancestors, since the beginning of organisms on this planet, they have been sexually reproducing. And the only reason, there was an unbroken chain of reproduction that allows us to be here. So you could, in some sense, say it's one of the most things that exist for biological organisms on this planet. The second thing, we're all born naked, all animals are naked. How is it possible that we managed somehow, as a human race, or most of us, I guess, to feel ashamed of our naked bodies and to feel ashamed about our sexuality, since it's so essential for our very existence? This is one of the most interesting questions which I could never get a grasp on.
Why it happened like this?
Yeah, why? How? What makes us? Like, it's something like, and some would tell you, breathing is really bad. You shouldn't breathe. Reduce it to the bare minimum. If you breathe too much, you know, like, it would be very hard to make people believe it because it's so important, right?
I know, yes.
How did they make it with sexuality? Why are we so ashamed?
Yeah, I think that, you know, if you go back to 3,000 years ago with Moses climbing Mount Sinai and being like, you shall not commit adultery. And, you know, the reason why sexuality needed to be tamed, right? For instance, you will restrict to have sex only with your partner within the context of marriage, is because my guess is that society was in a real mess. You know, people were having too much random sex, and then at some point you have these prophets coming and say, listen guys, we've got to have some order over here, because you have those lands over here, and you have a child, but we don't know if it's a child from the other farmer, and we don't know so we need to have some order. And nowadays loyalty within relationships, within the family structure, is one of the essential elements of that stabilizes society. Yeah. And so I think that it plays a role which is really important, and it is very intentional and very much designed like that. But now, from going to something that is useful to something that is completely shamed and something that becomes taboo, then it's a very small step. It's like within 15 years you can do anything. Anything becomes taboo. Like, for instance, even the word, you know, it's just like suddenly there are certain things in modern world that suddenly become taboo in just like 5 years, in no time. Suddenly it becomes something that we're not allowed to talk about. Because, so that's one thing, right? It's like there is the sexuality, why it has been shamed and why it has been suppressed. I think that the clothes or not clothes, being naked or not naked, I think that has to do with, you know, social norms, and also religion kicks in. My understanding is that in Bali, 100 years ago, women would be walking around topless, right? And then Christianity comes.
Or in tribes, like in African tribes, people are really naked. Yeah,
exactly.
So the reason why this is so fascinating is that's a very good explanation, by the way. Thank you very much. I think like sexual shame is one of the main reasons for like this huge sexual shadow, like pornography on the not so bad side, and rape on the very bad side, because like it's they try to repress something that can't be repressed, tame something that can't be tamed. But I think it's also like something that holds a lot of guys back. So when I was doing my dating coaching business in Australia, I had lots of people from India and from China, and it seemed they were particularly funny around this idea of women and sexuality, and I think that was holding them back a lot. So what can a man do who has a lot of shame in this topic to actually get rid of this shame and be more sexually liberated?
Yeah, that's a good question. Where do we start with all that? The things that come to mind is, first, get used to be perceptive with your nakedness, with comfortable with your body, with self-love. There are lots of many practices that we can engage into, which are solo practices, right? For instance, just explore touch on our own body. That's a good place. Most men are going to have a relationship with their genitals which is very abusive.
Yeah,
it's going to be, you know, there is going to be this intensity to force ejaculation, and there is not much nurturing behind that. So I think that developing a relationship with our bodies, which is much more nurturing and caring and softening, that's one aspect. And then moving really one step at a time. You know, this is why you have workshops around conscious sexuality, because it's like you are in a context which is safe, where the boundaries are clear, and then you take one step at a time. And this doesn't mean even nakedness, but just precisely, you know, starting with breathing, with eye gazing, with slight touch, and then you start becoming and more used to it. Like, for instance, over here, there is a lot of contact dance, right, in the Ubud community. Yeah. So dancing, and it's not just technical. Of course, there is sensuality. The moment skins are touching, there is oxytocin that is being built. There is something really powerful that happens, and that's through that. And it's not an erotic exchange. That's not the goal, of it's not the target, but there is a flow or something that is created where suddenly there is a very intimate moment with another human being that can be created. So that's the idea, you know. You go like, okay, where can we expand into that? And for instance, if I have a tribe of men coming, I will try to feel where is their limit of comfort, and then I go like, okay, you have an edge over here, why don't we take one small step in that direction? It's like if you were never surfed before, you go, you start with small waves. You don't jump into the storms of the water straight away and get crushed by the corals, right?
Great, fantastic, amazing. Thank you so much. All right, so another big topic that fits right into Tantra is actually sexual polarity. So years ago, I read this book by David Data, The Way of the Superior Man, where I heard the first time about sexual polarity.
Yes.
My understanding was that when a man steps into his masculine and a woman steps into her feminine, then there's a very strong polarity.
Yes.
What's your take on sexual polarity?
Sexual polarity. Okay, I'm going to use one of these diagrams because this really helps. I'm going to direct it over here. So this is a model of what our personality can look like, but it's also a model of what a relationship can look like. And you have two polarities. You have the light and the darkness, which are two aspects that we have inside of us. If you're watching this video, my guess is that you probably have some degree of darkness inside of you and some degree of light, two of them. And it's just a model, okay? It's like polarity of life. Darkness is not evil, it's just a quality. So you have this polarity
light
along that, along that line. Some people are going to be very much into the light and other people are going to be more into their darkness, more aggressive towards life. And the darkness can be mature or immature, right? And then we have the feminine and masculine polarity. So when you're in a relationship, you're going to have a polarity that is being created. For instance, a woman might be here, and then you might be over here.
But so the polarity goes not necessarily like this, but it might be actually like that. So a woman who is very much in her light feminine might be very attracted to a man in his dark masculine. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, for instance. It can go in lots of different ways. But for instance, if you have a couple and the woman is in her light feminine and the man is in his light masculine and the darkness is not embodied, most of the times what this means is that they are going to be to have a lightness and a lack of grounding and foundation. It means that they are going to be maybe vulnerable to shadow outbreaks, or they are going to be very sensitive. If a woman is in her light feminine and doesn't have access to her darkness, there is going to be potentially lots of insecurities, lack of safety. These are the shadows of the light feminine. And if a man
and the shadows are on both sides, I see.
The shadows, you know, the shadows are can be everywhere. Like for instance, you can have shadows of the darkness, shadows of the dark feminine, shadows of the dark masculine. For instance, an immature shadow of the dark masculine is being abusive, being hyper-controlling. That will be a shadow of the dark masculine. It can be the same for women. But a dark masculine who is going to be into his power and into his maturity is going to be a protector. He's going to be somebody who owns a lot of darkness but knows how to direct it and how to use it.
Yeah.
It's the same for women. It's like a woman who is in her dark feminine is a woman who's got a lot of power, lots of impact. She might be successful in business, for instance, or she might be a really good mother, really good protective. And a woman who is in her light feminine and he's very centered in her light feminine is going to be super compassionate, super loving. You are in her field and you feel really held by the feminine, for instance. A man who is in his light masculine is going to transmit precisely this vibration or frequency of beauty. For instance, a god like Apollo, you know, plays music and he's beautiful, and that's a light masculine archetype. But now in today's world, a lot of the archetypes that we have to do with dark masculine warriors, you know, the Viking and the warriors in Hindu mythology, and the you know, gods like Subek and Anubis in Egyptian mythology. They are like dark. They are warriors and they are destroyers and creators at the same time. But they have a lot of that. And if you look at the archetype of Zeus or Poseidon, you know, holding that, go and search online for modern fantasy images of these gods, and they are like, oh, you know, there is something that is really powerful about them. So they anchor a lot of the dark masculine energy.
Yeah.
And the same when it comes to Shiva, well, Shiva can be transcendental.
Sadashiva or Adishiva, the original yogi meditating on top of the mountains, where he can be engaged, carry the trishula, the weapon, the power of destruction, to remove the obstacles on this planet, right? So when we go into those archetypes, we can be, you know, anywhere around that. I can be in my light feminine as well. Me as a man, I can be in my light feminine.
Yeah, and I want to go to this topic. So what I'm interested first is, so as I said, like I teach men how to be better in the world of dating, sex, and relationships. So in terms of attraction, sexual polarity is in the end, if I understand this right, about attraction. When this polarity is strong, then there's strong attraction. And when the polarity is weak, there's weak attraction. So what does it mean for you if a man steps into his masculine core, into his masculinity? And how would it be different if he was not very connected to his masculine, whether it's the dark or the light?
Yeah. So I want to acknowledge what, you know, the context in which Data put it. For me, it's not a match at 100%, but a lot of the things that he's saying are really right. Mm. So when you have a woman who is going to be in her light feminine and a man in his dark masculine, there is going to be a polarity, an attraction polarity that is going to be really solid. Now, for instance, I have a couple that I know well, and their polarity is she's in her darkness and he's in his light, masculine. Mm-hmm. So that polarity can work as well. I was in a relationship for many, many years where she was here and I was in the light masculine. She was taking care of things. Mm. She had the money, she was making decisions, and I was like in my light masculine, and it worked really well for an extended period of time.
Yeah.
Then at some point, I needed to keep on growing. Then I go like, okay, I need to start accessing my conquering drive and a little bit more. So I started moving more into my darkness, and that was kind of the end of our relationship at that point.
So you can play around on this spectrum.
Yeah,
so
the spectrum.
Something that I discovered was actually that through presence, for me, like masculine and divine masculine and presence is the same thing. So this is for meditation helped me actually to really stay in my presence.
Yes.
And especially around beautiful shaktis. So my experience is that like lots of men, especially when they're in front of a beautiful woman, they are not very present. They go into their head or they go into their genitals, go into sexual fantasies or they go into the head and say, oh my God, what should I say? What's going on? Oh my God, she's so beautiful. Is she liking me? Is she not liking me? And like relating it to more
So that's
like
what you're describing. What you're describing is light, masculine, shadows. So it's being in the immature zone of the light masculine.
Yeah.
The insecurities, the instability, not being able to hold the ground. That's exactly the shadows of the light
holding
masculine.
Holding the space,
exactly. So if you're not able, you are not able to be in presence of precisely the shakti or energy that represents a good polarity over there, it's because your system is not trained to be able to receive that, to circulate that energy. So of course, you know what this means is that a man will have to dive into the dark foundation and being able to be like and I've seen men transform and be in the presence of women and being really insecure and saying the wrong things and all of that and completely messing up a date, and then they do the work, and then I see them coming 3 months later, and there might be a beautiful woman coming into the space, and you know.
So and this is the right way actually to engage with women. I think there are several wrong ways. Like one is to be overly needy or aggressive and going for it too fast, and this is something I see even on with tantric men on tantra festivals in the temple. You see, they build up a connection, then in the temple they get like too aggressive, they go too fast, and it's fascinating for me because I can see that the woman is like, I was like, oh, this is going too fast. I mean, I had women tell me after the Ibiza Tantra Fest, like, oh, I have this connection with this guy, but like as soon as we're in the temple, it was all too fast and got turned off, and my attraction was gone.
Yeah, exactly.
So that's one.
So that's like a foundation. The man is not grounded in his dark masculine.
Mm-hmm.
And there is precisely the neediness, the insecurity, the instability, and that creates, you know, because the woman wants to feel the foundation of the man. She needs to feel like precisely the way Daida puts it is like she needs to feel like the man is like a rock. Like he can hold the space, he can be solid and not be in a place, because what she does is like she imagines
being married with that man, or being as a potential father of the children, and she sees the degree of instability or insecurity, she was like, that man cannot be a protector. He doesn't score high in the warrior power, because a woman will come from another tribe and just be in front of him, and he's going to completely lose himself. So that doesn't create a sense of safety for the woman.
So something I find interesting, since I'm not pushing for sex quickly, so now what I'm doing with women when I meet them, I'm very slow, I'm very relaxed, and what I notice is there's some sort of a role reversal. So since I'm not pushing, like trying to make things happen quickly,
yes.
It happened to me several times now, I didn't make the move, so the woman starts making the move and starting actually to take over the usually masculine role. Can you explain that somehow, or have you experienced that yourself?
Yeah, many times. I think that precisely, you know, the polarity in the, if we move into the will of consent, right, with the polarity of taking and allowing, and the polarity of receiving and giving, right? So the taker sometimes is going to be the man. The man traditionally can be the predator and, you know, taking initiative, and the woman is going to be receiving. You see that very much in the animal world. Like, for instance, when you see two lions copulating, connecting, it's like he's going to be biting her neck, he's going to be dominant, he's going to be on top, and she's just like, you know, she's not aggressively taking. So that's the polarity that we have in mind. Naturally, the male will be usually in nature will be the dominant force, unless you are praying mantis and you get eaten as a male by the female when the act is finished, right?
Yeah.
So it's like you have lots of variation in that. And the good news is that within our human species, we have lots of space to play. It's like sometimes a woman can come and literally be like, I'm going to fuck you.
Yeah.
And I'm going to take my pleasure because it feels really good for me to own that power and own that desire. And you as a man, you can be, I'm going to allow it.
Yeah.
I'm going to allow. But I've seen very often men being uncomfortable with the polarization shift. If the woman becomes the taker, I see sometimes, you know, it's like a turn off. It's like guys like not necessarily knowing how to receive it. So it's something that, you know, we have, it's like different chords, different musical sounds or different instruments or different ways of engaging. We have to learn a little bit what works for us. And in a couple, very often there is going to be one of the polarities that is really strongly established, but it's good to play with the range.
Yeah.
Because otherwise we get stuck in one.
So there's one thing you said actually, like initiating. And in my experience, like one of the roles of the masculine is actually initiating. And I think, what's your take? So I think it's important in dating and relationships that the man is initiating, because it is usually the man who starts the conversation. It's usually the man to ask her out on, ask for the phone number, ask for the first date, invites her over, invites her for the dinner, invites her, right?
Yeah.
But actually, so I think this is great and important, and of course it can be role reversed, but like it's usually the man initiating. But what's very important, we have this distinction, it shouldn't be predatorial. So like stepping into the right direction, initiating, but without being predatorial.
Without being predatorial. So that's an interesting one. Can I contradict you on that one?
Yeah, sure.
So in my experience, I think that women love it when a man is a predator, when it's mature predator.
Yeah. I'm talking like the immature.
The immature,
predator.
Exactly. So
because like
be
I work with guys who are usually not so experienced, and they are either too shy or go too fast. So I'm talking about the immature. This
exactly.
The
so if it's the immature predator with the forceful intention of connecting with a woman, then that's of course going to be a turn off. What was the question?
To be initiating without being predatorial in a needy sense.
Yeah, exactly. So it's, you know, it's a little bit like playing music, right? It's an art form. It's not like predator or not predator, initiating or not initiating. It's like
there is going to be moments where you're playing the music, you know, right? You have a guitar and you're playing to a crowd, and certain rhythm or certain flow or certain emotions are going to work really well with that crowd.
Yeah.
So it's like figuring out for a woman, you're in a, on a date and you try something and you make a move that is a little bit too aggressive and you think that she's going to be turned off, but she's turned on. And then you, with another woman, you might do the same move and then realize. So it's all like figuring out from a sensitive place and being in tune with the reactions and witnessing what works. But what I can tell you is that it is that somebody who can go into the range of softness and kindness and into the range of intensity and have the full range of possible expressions of sexual expression is somebody who is more interesting to be with than somebody who can play only one card.
Right?
So if we are dogmatic about it and we go like, okay, the man always have to initiate and so on, I go like, no, it's like, let's dissolve the gender roles, you know, let's break all that down. I had probably like two or three of my core relationships in my life, long term, were initiated by my women. I gave up and she came back, you know, multiple times, and that happened multiple times in my life. And I find, you know, when a woman comes to me and is really, I find it super sexy. It's beautiful.
Yeah.
And so instead of being like, no, I'm supposed to be initiating, otherwise I don't feel like a man. And, you know, women go like, I'm having this conversation also in coaching. I tell women, yeah, of course, initiate. Just don't be too aggressive.
So,
you know,
so
pushy.
This is the thing. I mean, you're Shiva, you know, like, I
am
think
Shiva. I like that.
For you, I think the world of dating and women looks very different than to the average guy, and certainly very different to the guys that I'm working with. So the guys I'm working with, from without initiating, most of them, like, nothing happens in the world. That's the kind of guys that often they don't even get noticed when they're on a festival. They're not the center of attention. People don't look at them, give them a they're not facilitators, you know, they don't have a crowd around them. So this is the kind of people I'm working for. But I understand when you're on a certain level, then you don't have to play this role anymore.
Yeah.
Actually, now for me, like, I was coming from this place where I had to do all this initiation.
Yes.
And that worked very well, actually. Like, my dating life improved a lot. And it led me, over the years in Tantra, it led me to a place where I'm not doing this anymore, where I'm like leaning back and relaxing.
Yeah.
But like,
I hear you.
The average guy, for him, if he doesn't initiate, if he just waits for things to happen,
no,
my experience does not happen and did not happen in my
early
life.
Yeah. No, so that's a good point. If we talk directly to your audience and a couple of tips that would really help them.
Yes, please.
It's like, just establish connection with 10 people every day. It's like, talk to people. It doesn't have to be attractive women. It doesn't have to be even women. It can be anybody. Just captivate and cultivate the art of establishing connections, establishing conversations that are interesting. Once this skill is activated, then it's easier to direct it to a woman that you're really attracted to. But first, it's like, just open the heart and connect and be fun to be around, right?
Good point. So why not just focus, this is, so I get it completely, but why not focus just on the beautiful women? Why? Because this is what people do when they learn to be a little bit more confident, open conversations. They all of a sudden just want to talk to the pretty girls. Why would that not be?
Well, because you have to train the skills. It's like, you have to train the skills. Again, if we take the metaphor of surfing, it's like, you're not just going to be surfing once you, if you haven't been surfing before, and suddenly you go like, oh, there is like this really big wave coming up, and then you go, I'm going to catch that and go through a tunnel. It's like, that might not work the first time, even though that would be the peak experience. First, you have to start with small waves and play. And so use every opportunity that you have to connect. I mean, I do that all the time. I'm connecting with women that I might not be interested in having a date with, or that we will probably not be partners, but we're having a really juicy and interesting conversation right now, right?
Yeah. So maybe I could summarize this in saying, like, when you're in the beginner level, it's probably a good idea to step into your masculine and to be the initiator. And I guess what's good for everyone is actually to practice presence, which is, for me, the essence of the divine masculine is presence.
Yes.
And then when you're more advanced, I guess, it's actually, and this is probably the path we've been on for a long time, is to integrate the inner feminine. So could you explain like to us, like, what does it mean for men to integrate the inner feminine, and why is it important, and how would it help you?
Yeah, that's such an important question, man. Thank you for all that. I love all these questions. This is great. So integrating the feminine, a few core aspects. The first one that comes to mind is emotional and energetic fluidity. As men, we go like, this is the way things are, boom, you know, there is a rigidity that comes. Mm-hmm. And then you start dating somebody and you go like, okay, the woman is supposed to be doing that, the man. Having emotional energetic fluidity means being able to navigate emotions and being able to navigate the feminine, being able to play with energies instead of sticking to a box, right? That's, for me, being in my feminine means that. It means that I'm moving around instead of being like a robot, like a rigid, instead of being completely linear, being much more fluid.
Yeah.
For instance, in the dance, it's non-linear movements. In life in general, instead of having a schedule that is, okay, 7 o'clock I wake up, here is a schedule, here is exactly, I know exactly what is going to happen during the day, at 7 o'clock I come back, I go to the gym 1 hour, here's what I'm going to eat. So men tend to have a certain rigidity on that. What I love about my life is precisely that the feminine is integrated to a certain point. What this means is that I vaguely know what's going to happen in the day, but there is lots of spaciousness and freedom to improvise as things come. And so that for me means being my feminine. You have a concept in ancient Greece, and you have Chronos, you know, two ways of looking at time. Chronos is the linear time. It's like a chronometer, Chronos, right?
Yeah.
It's the god of time. And it goes boom, 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 boom. That's Chronos. It's linear, it's predictable. Then you go into Kairos. And Kairos is the opposite wave of time. It's wave is going, the time is going to be flexible. It means being at the right time at the right place.
Yeah.
Right?
Yes.
It means, for instance, time in a day can be like, you know, flexible. And
especially here in Ubud, huh?
Exactly.
Divine timing.
Exactly, divine timing. And so engaging in the day, for instance, with this idea in mind, being much more into the Kairos, because the Western world is full on Chronos.
Yeah.
It's like everything is dominated. You go into New York and it's straight lines. You see the avenues and then you have the network and then you have the internet and everything is rationalized, right? This is the power of the rational mind.
Yeah.
But then when you go in nature, nature doesn't, is not rational.
Yeah.
It's like, so if we go into the waterfalls and we start playing there and then you merge with nature and you're washed away by a wave or, so what enters into our field is a connection with precisely feminine energies.
So this is a very good point, because a lot of the people I work with are guys who are coming from a like very masculine, logic-oriented field.
Exactly.
So that means they're a lot in the head, and this is a beautiful take, actually. A great way of explaining that. A great way of explaining is actually stepping into the feminine, which means like getting maybe out of the head and more into the heart. And
yes,
more in emotions and feeling and out of like thinking constructs, logic, because not everything is always logical.
Exactly.
And especially the world of dating, or I think coupling, you call it?
Yes.
Yeah, this term coupling, sorry, like I'm super interested. You mentioned that I have not heard this term coupling. What does that mean for you?
It's being in a coupling, in a couple experience.
Yeah.
Coupling means the art of being in a relationship.
Mm. Coupling is the art of being in a relationship. Okay.
Yeah. So, it's a good one. And precisely tantric coupling is the word that I use.
And yesterday,
it's like how do you bring the divinity within that?
Yesterday at your event, I realized that we have this thing which we both teach and practice.
Yeah.
I don't know how you call it. I call it relationship values.
Yes.
And it's actually very similar to what you have. So I have actually written down for me on a list like everything I want in a relationship.
Yes.
And from everything I want in a relationship, I have like a small short section of must have. These are things I must have.
Yes.
And then at the bottom of this list, there's things I must not have. Like one is enough. So for example, one of the lists that must not have is like violence. This is something I do not accept in my life, whether it's physical or emotional. One thing I must have on the wants list, I need to have sexual attraction. I need to have someone who is flexible.
Yes.
For example. Yeah. So this is how do you call this in your
In my system, I call that the coupling codes.
The coupling codes.
Yeah.
Great.
And the coupling codes. Yeah. How many of them do you have?
So I have a very short list of definitely must-haves and a very short list of definitely deal breakers.
Yeah, deal breakers.
And then there's like a long list of things that I want to have.
Preferences.
But preferences. I don't have to have them, and things I don't want, but I can live with them. Because if you make the list too long with a must and must not, like your possibility becomes smaller. And it helped me already. On the last Tantra Festival, I met a woman who was very attractive to me in a physical sense. But then very shortly, I realized there's two deal breakers. One of them was she was actually interested in, she didn't say it that way, in a provider or sugar daddy.
Yes.
And for me, it's a deal breaker. Not that I wouldn't provide for someone if it's necessary, but like for me, it's a deal breaker if this person is like, this is what I want, this is what I must have. I need someone who actually provides for me. This was a deal breaker. And yeah, it helped me very quickly, and actually very quickly, consciously, I could say, hey, I realized, as much as I like you, we cannot be in a relationship. And this actually coupling code or relationship value helped me. So how could you, like, when you are in a relationship, how can you translate to what you called yesterday the agreements? Because you will not always perfectly agree on everything, but like, how could you actually take this and then would you recommend your clients to actually say when they're in a relationship, they write down certain agreements?
It's a very intuitive thing, right? Very often, you will have people jumping into a relationship and not even talking about the agreements. It will
right.
be like
just
the
assumptions.
Yeah, the assumptions and the unspoken agreements are, for instance, loyalty, clarity, respect, love, sexual openness, you know, things like that.
Yeah.
It's like it's part of the unspoken agreements. Now when we engage into it from a more intentional way, then we're gonna check these things. We're gonna be like, okay, is it okay to have sex with other people if we're in a relationship?
Yeah.
Yes or no? Person goes, no. No. Okay, clear.
You shouldn't engage in sexuality, in my opinion.
Well, I mean, it depends.
There is
such a diversity. It's whatever works for this specific couple. I mean, that's the way I look at it. So you go like, okay, first the sexual boundaries, right? Is it okay to have sex with other people or no? Is it okay to have friends of the opposite sex if you are a straight couple, right?
What do you call the intersensuality?
Well, you have polyamory and polysensuality.
Polysensuality.
But it doesn't have to be polysensuality. Like you can have polysensuality without having actually active friendships from the opposite sex. You know, you can have the polysensuality in different contexts. So you can, navigating the agreements means that you have to, you know, sit down and check on the places where there might be some, but it's relatively simple. The places where there might be disagreements are, you know, then you check on money, for instance, precisely. Oh, I need you to be the provider. I'm not going to, you go like, okay, well, that doesn't seem to be a match for me.
Yeah.
So there might be deal breakers, and then there might be preferences, there might be points of friction that require a little bit of adaptation. Things around lifestyle, you know, use of substances. Like I've got at least two or three couples that I know that broke up because one guy was smoking marijuana and the woman couldn't stand it. Right? So that was a deal breaker. Another one with alcohol, substance abuse and addictions, you know, those kind of things. You go like, okay, certain shadows are present in the field and it's not allowing us to dive deeper. It doesn't bring me the safety that I need. So those are the kind of things that need to be checked. And then once you're in a relationship, then allow for this relationship and allow for the agreements to keep on evolving depending on what comes up. For instance, you know, I noticed that you might spend like 3-4 days without sending me a message, and I miss that. I would love to feel you more present even when we don't see each other. So at least a small message every day would be really nice.
Yeah.
People are like, oh yeah,
that's a preference. It's not a deal breaker.
So it's not a thing you do once and then forget about. It's something you do on a regular basis, checking in.
I would say, for instance, with the agreements and the foundation, this is what I call the yuga rita, right? The yuga is coupling in Sanskrit, and the rita is the structure of the law. And so you have the coupling foundation. And once this is established, most of the times that's more or less what is going to stay. It's present. But then there is going to be moments where one of or both partners needs to go into the foundation and say, there is something there that is not working for me.
Yeah.
And so we need to change that. For instance, the way we are using our money right now is not in line with what I would like to have in my life. So what you are going to do is this. What I suggest that couples do is, like, every week you have a check-in.
Yeah.
And then sometimes in this check-in, there is going to be something fundamental in the agreements that needs to be changed.
Mm-hmm.
But in my experience, most of the times the agreements are established, then it's like small requests being added. Like the requests are like, I would love to prioritize sex a little bit more in our lives, for instance. Or I would love to have a little bit of time apart.
Right.
I need to have more spaciousness in the relationship, for instance. Those are like requests or preferences or suggestions that will come at a later stage in the evolution of the relationship.
Amazing. Thank you so much. That is really good stuff for relationships, I think, for everyone.
Mm.
I would like to start rounding up with maybe a couple of tips for newbies.
Yes.
If you're comfortable. What would be for a newbie, for a man who is new in the world of Tantra and conscious communities, what's something that would help him to become more attractive to women?
The first one that comes to mind is self-care. Just take care of yourself. If the woman sees you and she goes like, I don't see the result of you loving yourself. It's like, you're not taking care of yourself. So the self-care part is really important, you know, on a more worldly level. It's just hygiene and presence and so on. That's the first one. The second one is stay present when challenges emerge. Like if you have your potential partner or your partner going through really a tough time and having really intense emotions, be like, oh, that's interesting. Wow, that's a full dimension or an expression of the feminine. It might not be mature, it might be toxic, it might be whatever this might be. Just stay present and witness what is coming. She wants to be seen.
Yeah.
She wants to be seen. She wants to be heard.
See
she wants
the goddess.
Yes. And see the full dimension of who she is. So when you're having sex with a woman, you're in a relationship with that woman, you're not just dating the light, beauty, and everything that is comfortable. You're dating the full dimension of who she is. And within what she is, there might be aspects that might feel uncomfortable to you. So stay present with that. Acknowledge them. Offer some gratitude for those aspects as well. You're in a bad mood today. Wow, you're having a tantrum. And be curious about it. Where does that come from? How does it work?
Stay in Shiva energy, the witnessing.
Yeah.
Be non-reactive.
Non-reactive, but interested, you know, actively listening. It's like, it looks like you're going through really something deep and profound today. I'm right here. Do you want to tell me what's happening? And then open up and then offer precisely this space of nurturing to be able to receive that. Another one is create safety. Like create safety.
Uh-huh.
Be in a space where precisely the woman feels like she can be real with you.
Mm-hmm.
She doesn't have to filter, she doesn't have to feel shamed by the thing, by her beliefs or what
she
thinks.
So work on the sexual shame, because if you feel ashamed about your sexuality, she will probably not open up.
For instance, on the sexual level, but about anything. It's like, I cannot believe you said that. This is such a stupid thing to say. You're completely failing with your business, you're making the wrong choices, you know, shaming, blaming, attacking, criticizing. There is about, you know, 50, 60 communication patterns that we can use in relationships and also on social media or everywhere that are going to be like criticizing, assuming, projecting, shaming, all of that, being aggressive, disrespecting, condescending, mansplaining everything. Stop mansplaining. It's just like a woman goes through something, through an intense emotion, and says, oh yeah, you're doing, yeah, right now it's happening because then and you have a whole story behind it.
Is it like advice giving also? Or is
yeah,
it
advice giving as well. It's like a woman, you know, one of my past lovers, one day she was to me and she says, you will never fully get me. You will never fully understand me. Sometimes I'm going to do things that are going to be completely incoherent. Mm. Just let me be. Mm-hmm. Let me be. You don't have to explain, and you will never fully comprehend me or understand. And I was like, no, I know who you are. I know what's happening. But sometimes it's just like, just observe the beauty of the chaos. Observe and witness that, and allow for the woman to be celebrated in the full dimension of who she is. Mm-hmm. This doesn't mean that you don't have boundaries. This doesn't mean that you tolerate absolutely everything. But it means that there is spaciousness, right? And this is really, instead of loving a woman by being like, I love you, and I'm going to control you, and I'm going to domesticate you to fit within the image or within the agenda that I have. Mm-hmm. No, you go like, I celebrate you and I open space around you. I want the Shakti inside of you to be liberated. Mm-hmm. The thing that I love the most about you is your freedom and the spontaneity and the ups and downs in the emotions. That's what we want to celebrate as men. Honor the Shakti, you know, the feminine energy has been suppressed on this planet for the last 2,000 years. We have been burning women for hundreds of years because of just being female. Yeah. It's horrible.
Yeah.
So it's time to shift this story. It's not about women being better than men or the same the other way around, but we need to heal all of that as a human race, otherwise we're not going to go one step further. We are stuck into narratives and stories that don't celebrate each other's genders. Even now, you know, it goes the other way around as well. Like now it's like toxic masculinity that is being projected, and a lot of the toxic masculinity is present, and masculinity is beautiful.
Yeah. So you could summarize it as like be present, be curious about the feminine, appreciate the divine feminine in its ups and downs and its emotional nature, but still have boundaries. Would you summarize it this way? What did you say?
Yeah, part of what you're saying right now matches that, her boundaries. And I would say that, you know, the big, big step in my awakening and my connection with women is the moment I stop trying to control the woman in my life.
Stop trying to control women in your life.
Stop trying to control and stop trying to domesticate the woman to fit into what makes you comfortable. Release control, open space.
Release control, open space. Wow, this is words from a master and from a very high level. So I would say let's round this up here. I think this is one of the highest arts to be able to be on such a high level where you can release control, where you can accept, where you can appreciate, where you're not influenced by the ups and downs. So beautiful. Thank you so much.
It's a pleasure.
In the end, could you share with us like what are your upcoming events and how can people find you on social media?
On social media, I'm Vital Coaching in most of my channels, Instagram, on YouTube, Vital Coaching. And you can also search for Shiva Rajaya, that's my name. And my core website where everything is summarized is vitalcoaching.com. That's it. And
we see you in the near future?
I'm probably in most dances. Every time there is a fun event in town, people go like, oh, you are everywhere.
I've got some clothes walking around, you
know. No, but it's and what I encourage you to do, if you're feeling intrigued by this video, you're going to post some links probably to my staff, so feel free to reach out. If I feel that we need to go deeper into a topic and have a coaching session, and we can organize that. But most of the times, I'm really happy if you just have a couple of questions and I can check that. And if we need to connect, we can do a quick video chat, you know, on the specific topic. And then after that, if you feel, okay, I really want to go deeper, then we can dive deeper into those topics in sessions. And we are having a men's gathering every Tuesday right now at my temple. So this one is in on my link tree that you find in on the Instagram. And then we are having a mixed group gathering. So this is for men and women where we explore the dynamics of relationships, dating and sex life. And it's really very safe. We don't dive into profound intimacy. Nobody gets naked, except if we are in the jungle and by the river, or, you know. But it's really a safe context. It's for beginners, people who want to be introduced to that. So feel free to reach out. And I'm a loving, caring man. So feel free to, yeah, send me the questions. And you are amazing, brother. I'm so happy you're doing this work.
Thank you so much. Thank you for inviting me. I appreciate it a lot that you give this. I understand your time is precious. So thank you so much.
It's a pleasure. We do a Jaya to the sky?
Yes.
Five times. Jaya! 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 Jaya!
Woohoo!
Jaya means victory. It's a good practice to do in the morning when you wake up. It will make your neighbors really happy.
Absolutely. And something we do at his events all the time.
Yes, exactly.
All right. Checking out of Ubud. Thank you so much for listening. I hope you got something out of this interview. Peace.
Take care.